It is a wrenching dilemma. Your child is born with the anatomy of both a boy and a girl. These children used to be known as hermaphrodites. Now they're called simply intersex. In the hospital, there's often pressure to perform surgery right away to make the gender clear. But tonight, you're going to meet someone who grew up and concluded the choice that was made was wrong. Here's my Nightline co-anchor, Juju Chang.
It's the first question when a baby's born. Is it a boy or a girl? Sometimes the answer isn't that simple.
They told me that he was intersex.
Intersex, meaning born with both male and female genitals. Pamela and Mark Crawford weren't bothered by the fact that the baby they were about to adopt was intersex.
That seemed like no big deal. Okay, what else?
It's more common than you might think. Roughly one in every 2,000 babies are born intersex each year. There's no clear protocol on how to treat intersex children. For decades, doctors have quote-unquote fixed the situation by surgically choosing one gender or the other. But now more parents are questioning whether that's the right thing to do.
The first thing I said when we heard, I said, don't let him get the surgery. He hasn't gotten the surgery, has he?
But he had. Just after his first birthday, while in the custody of the state of South Carolina, their intersex baby, MC, had been transformed surgically into a girl. But it was clear, even in toddlerhood, that MC felt and acted like a boy.
He was like, I feel weird because I don't feel like I should be going into the girls' room.
MC is now 9 years old. His parents asked us to keep his face off camera.
This is definitely the toy box of a little guy.
He can just play with this stuff for hours.
MC's brother, Ben, says his little brother was robbed of his right to fully live as a man.
What's happened to him was unnecessary, unjust, unconsented.
And he's been castrated.
And he's been castrated. So that is likely to have a lifelong impact.
And irreversible.
And irreversible.
35-year-old Saifa says he knows all about irreversible. Like MC, he was born intersex. A doctor assigned him female at birth, but it led to years of agonizing confusion.
At what age did you start questioning your gender?
Up until the age of 7, I thought that I was a boy. I was like, I'm a boy.
Saifa grew up in the Bronx, wearing Catholic schoolgirl uniforms, even went to the prom. It wasn't until college that Saifa started to ask serious questions. That's when he got a hold of his medical records.
Initially, they had wrote that I had ambiguous genitalia. They checked it, but then they scratched it out and they put that I was normal. Then I felt betrayed.
You were kept in the dark.
Of course.
Saifa says he had no idea that he even had undescended testes and no idea that a surgery at age 13 turned him biologically into a girl, though Saifa's mother tells us she trusted the doctors and consented to the procedure. But years later, Saifa still felt like a man. In his mid-20s, he decided to live as one.
I want to get the air bubbles out.
As a result, every week he must inject himself with testosterone.
But I have a fear of, like, having man boobs.
And some in the intersex community are increasingly vocal.
These people are not disordered. They're just a bit different from other people.
Protesting against premature operations performed on children. Arguing intersex people should have the right to decide for themselves when they're ready. Saifa is in agreement.
I do feel like I need to wear a suit.
And now is getting ready for an occasion more than 20 years in the making.
This is it. This is like a big moment.
He is about to meet with the doctor who surgically removed his testicles at the age of 13, transforming him into a girl with his mother's consent. A surgery he says he never wanted.
I'll probably have a whole bunch of emotions that come up.
You know, he's the surgeon's signature right here, Terry Hensel.
Dr. Terry Hensel, notable in the field of pediatric urology for 30 years.
What would you say to Dr. Hensel if you were face to face with him today?
I think I would just ask him questions because he's a human being. And I think human beings make mistakes.
Turns out he's still practicing and a professor emeritus at Columbia University. He says new parents with an intersex baby are often desperate to have their child fixed, surgically turned into a boy or girl as fast as possible.
So have you had parents thank you for intervening early?
All the time.
And what do they say?
Well, thank you for giving me my little girl. It's microphallus.
The photos are too graphic to show on television, but Dr. Hensel wanted me to see just how ambiguous these cases can be.
What do you tell mommy that is?
Yeah, what is that?
Saifa argues in his case, there was no medical urgency. But many doctors argue doing it younger can avoid painful scarring down the road, both physically and emotionally.
I think it's more parents' anxiety about information being disseminated about their abnormal child.
But the very definition of gender normality is evolving.
A person's biological sex does not determine that their gender.
Right, so gender is not in the genitalia.
It's not. It's in the brain, it's in the spirit, it's in the heart.
Nowadays, gender identity is more open, but during Cypher's time, it was kept quiet.
The criticism always is that, oh, you know, these doctors, they're playing God.
No, I used to, and I really liked it, but it wasn't the right thing to do.
There's a real sense that if patients, even patients from 20 years out, were listened to, were heard, that would be a big step forward.
Huge. I totally and thoroughly 100% agree.
So we asked Dr. Hensel if he'd meet with Cypher.
You'd be open to that.
True.
Today, Cypher is on his way from Atlanta to New Jersey for the meeting with Dr. Hensel.
I think it just feels so surreal. I haven't seen this man in 20 plus years.
What makes you nervous?
I have the stories of so many people.
That you're walking in there with?
Yeah.
Cypher says he never had a chance to be heard, but now that's about to change.
Terry Hensel?
Oh, Sean Cypher Wall.
Hi.
Hey.
But before the dialogue even begins, Dr. Hensel tries to shut down the interview.
If something gets said and it's just the wrong twist, I can't let that happen. I can't. I hope you understand that.
But Cypher calmly and gently refuses to take no for an answer.
And if you had it to do all over again, if you saw me as a baby with ambiguous genitalia,
I would bring it to a gender committee.
Right.
We would talk about the pros and the cons. If you have testosterone, you have a male brain.
Right.
And a male brain is a male brain is a male brain.
These days, many hospitals rely on a gender committee made up of an endocrinologist, ethicist, psychologist, even clergy, which decides the course of action.
Point is that what happened to you, it was done not out of malice or not out of lack of thinking about it. It was done because that was the state of the art in 19, whatever the date was. I wanted to make sure that you understand that our learning curve has increased dramatically.
That's when I joined the conversation.
But I'm wondering if you think physicians out there, or you yourself, who have some remorse about some of the surgeries that were done.
And no, I have no regrets. Now, would I have done things differently? Absolutely. But I don't. I was dealing in my heart of hearts with what I thought was the right thing to do.
So, what did you think?
I think it was so interesting, that moment when he said that he didn't have any regrets. Like, I was like, wow, that's, and I guess, you know, you would have to do that in order to avoid feeling.
We asked Dr. Hensel to clarify his lack of regret.
If you want the truth, I don't feel regret about it, because I did the best I could do based on what I knew.
Because there's no clear protocol on how to treat intersex children, these operations are still happening, which is why the Crawfords are suing doctors at Medical University of South Carolina and the state, claiming they assigned their adopted child the wrong gender. The case involving their son, MC, could potentially provide a first-of-its-kind, precedent-setting ruling. We reached out to the hospital where the surgery was performed. They declined our request for an interview but issued this statement. MUSC will vigorously defend in this case with a preponderance of evidence that will also serve to explain why MUSC does not accept the information as alleged.
There was no justification for mutilating his genitals. That's what they did. They removed his penis. They did unnecessary surgery on a happy, healthy kid.
For Nightline, I'm Juju Chang in Charleston, South Carolina.